I like the new arrangement. I like it, James. I liked it. I like the singers over here where I could actually look at you. Made me nervous. So, no, not really. I'm just kidding. So it's kind of cool. Well, welcome this morning to HBF. It is good to see you. And if you have your Bibles, be turning to the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 3 is where we're going to start this morning. And I'm just going to do a little review. Last week, as most of you know, it was our vision conference. And I want to do a little vision exam this morning. And as I say that, Samuel, can you find your mother and get my spectacles out of my office on my desk? So I just realized that I'm looking at my notes. All of a sudden, I'm like, oh, boy, I need a vision exam myself. And so if you don't have a Bible, in the seat rack in front of you is a Bible. And on page 237 is where we're going to start. This morning. But before we get into the text this morning, I want to remind you that on April 9th, 1940, now the date escapes me, I don't have it in my notes either, but I believe it was 43, I'm not sure, well, what would 75 be? 75 minus today, 42. So in 1942, on April 9th, there was a thing that occurred today. It started today called the Bataan Death March. How many of you have heard of that? I'm just curious. How many of you have heard of that? So really, probably looks like maybe 50% of you. Yesterday was a big day of memorial all across the United States in various cities and places. And it memorializes this march that took place in the Philippines when the Japanese, after they invaded Pearl Harbor, they moved on, and then they took on the Philippines, and they captured several thousands of Philippine troops, and then along with that, many American soldiers that were there in the Philippines, and then they marched them 60 miles, and when they marched them 60 miles, the men were bayoneted, they were beaten, mistreated, they weren't fed, this was a terrible thing that happened. And then after that, if you were fortunate enough to survive, then you got to look forward to going to a Japanese prison, which was going to, ensure that you're going to get, continued treatment like that. And so it's a very sad and terrible, time in the history of World War II, and in that time, many men, of course, lost their life, and some men survived, and it was just, after the war was over, it was a mark, along with many other things, against Japan, and is noted in history, of course, as a war crime, because as these men marched, they just, continued and continuously brutalized them. And so today is Palm Sunday. And it's a day we remember the beginning of Jesus' journey, right? The triumphal entry into Jerusalem to his crucifixion. And it's just 1 week after his triumphal entry that, of course, they're crying, crucify him, crucify him. And we still remember Jesus' steps because they reveal the shallow and selfish and sinful nature of man and the selfishness and supernatural nature of our beloved Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so what a contrast that is. So the triumphant entry of the Lord Jesus Christ turned into a death march for him as well, as he went to the cross of Calvary and became, of course, sin for us, and he took our place on the cross. And so as we remember the journey from heaven to earth, right, Jesus Christ was born. We celebrate that at Christmas. Everybody gets excited. We exchange gifts, and it is, of course, an incredible time, and we should remember that. This week reminds us of the journey that Jesus took, from being acknowledged as the king, but being rejected as the savior of the world. And so it's a time that it reminds me of this death march. In World War II, Japan completely surrendered to the United States. Why? Well, because President Harry S. Truman finally came to the point that he says, I'll tell you what, we're just going to use overwhelming force. And of course, he obliterated Hiroshima, Nagasaki. And then finally the Japanese said, okay, we submit. We will bow our knee. We will give up. And I tell you, maybe we today, as we have the opportunity to preach the gospel, go forth and offer peace, right? The terms of peace are the gospel. Why? Because the wrath of God was placed on Jesus Christ. We'll be celebrating that next week. And we'll also celebrate the resurrection. And so that's a joyous time, and it ought to be a joyous time for us if you're saved today. But the reality is there's many people who aren't saved. And so they're on a death march. And they think it's bad today. Wait till they get to the other side if they don't know the Lord Jesus as their Savior. And may we do our part, right? May we do our part to reach them with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I think most of us today would say, you know, we've made peace with God through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe you've come in this morning and this discussion is a little bit like, whoa, heavy. Maybe you don't know your place in that. Okay, if that's the case, I just want you to know you're in a place where we want you to understand the love of God. God loves you. He loves you so much that he gave his son for you. He died on the cross for us. And we take that so seriously that we celebrate it every Sunday. I mean, that is really the essence of our salvation, is that we couldn't do it ourselves. So God took that on himself, and he provided that way of escape, and he loves us. And so we're so excited about that. And we've been given this good news, and we've been left here because our job is to share the good news. And that's why we have a vision conference. Because it reminds us of why we're here and what we're supposed to be doing, and then causes us to wonder, are we doing it? The church is comprised of saved or born again, spiritually regenerated, children of God who desire to give our lives in service to God. So this past week at HBF, during our vision conference, we really looked at that. What is it that God would have us to do? It was a week to evaluate God's vision for our church and for our lives and trust God to accomplish it. So vision is so important. It's what helps us get to our destination. Without vision, you can't get there. When we consider Jesus' first coming, we know, based on Hebrews chapter 12, that Jesus looked past the pain, right? Past the temporary inconvenience, to put it mildly, of his circumstances, to the result of his obedience, which was the reconciliation of those who would call upon him, and his, of course, unification in the Godhead. And so looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who is, the Bible says in Hebrews 12, he's the one who is the author and the finisher of our faith. He authorizes it. He finished it for us. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. You know, after a busy week like we've had, it's easy to faint. Whew. It's been a lot going on, really, the last several weeks, 3 weeks and three conferences. That's a lot to do. But the Bible tells us, let's not faint in our minds. Sometimes our bodies will fail, right? The flesh is weak, but make sure our minds never fail. We must be focused on things above. That's what Colossians 3 tells us, and that's so paramount, right? That's what our text tells us, that we have to be focused on the Lord Jesus Christ and the things that he has for us that are eternal. Else, we might faint in our minds, and we may not make the trip that God would have for us. Not meaning going to heaven if you're saved, but of course, getting home to heaven with all the joy that God would intend for our lives. And that brings me to the text this morning. Knowing that we know where we're going is the key to getting there, right? If you don't know where you're going, you're never going to get there, right? You get in the car, start it up. Where am I going? I don't know. Well, you might as well not pull out of the drive. You mean you can drive around the block, drive around town, drive up and down the highways. You know, the day may be coming when that'll be me, right? That'll when I get Alzheimer's or something. I don't know where I'm going. Just driving. But when you go somewhere, you know where you're going. You got to get to that destination. And having that understanding and that vision is the key to getting there. There's always going to be an obstacle in the way. There's always going to be something. But what gets you there is knowing that, hey, this is the spot I need to be in. This is the place that God has for me. And if you're born again this morning, you are a citizen of heaven. You're in destination. No matter what you face in this life, no matter how terrible it may be, it could be the baton death march. But you know what? If you're born again, that's just an inconvenience on the road to getting to heaven. And it's incredible, the power of God and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ in our life. And that brings us to our text in 1 Samuel chapter 3. I told you to turn there because knowing where we're going is the key to getting there. And seeing what lies beyond the travail of this life is what directs our steps through it and to it. So God has given us a good dose of vision this past week, and I pray this morning he'll give us a little more as we look at 1 Samuel chapter 3. And I'm just going to read the first 10 verses. And if you would, let's stand together as we look at this text. 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 1. The Bible says, "And the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was precious in those days. There was no open vision. And it came to pass at that time when Eli was laid down in his place and his eyes began to wax dim that he could not see. And ere the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was, and Samuel was laid down to sleep, that the Lord called Samuel and he answered, 'Here am I.' And he ran unto Eli and said, 'Here am I, for thou callest me.' And he said, 'I called not. Lie down again.' And he went and lay down. And the Lord called yet again Samuel. And Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here am I, for thou didst call me.' And he answered, 'I called not, my son. Lie down again.' Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, neither was the word of the Lord yet revealed unto him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. And he arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here am I, for thou didst call me.' And Eli perceived that the Lord had called the child. Therefore Eli said unto Samuel, 'Go lie down, and it shall be, if he call thee, that thou shalt say, "Speak, Lord, for the Lord heareth." So Samuel went and lay down in his place. And the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, 'Samuel, Samuel!' Then Samuel answered, 'Speak, for thy servant heareth.'" Heavenly Father, thank you for calling our name. Thank you for calling us to salvation. And Lord, thank you for hearing our prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you for this time to just look at your word. Thank you for your church. Thank you for the word of God that you've given us. Thank you for giving us a mission. Heavenly Father, this morning as we look into your word, I pray you quicken it in our hearts and our minds and our lives. Lord, that we would go out of here today excited about accomplishing the mission of God and the power of God for the glory of God. And we thank you so much for that word and your church. We pray, God, today a blessing on the reading, the hearing, and the living of the Word of God. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning as we start here, I want to start here because if we don't see Jesus as the Savior, of course, we'll perish. If we don't see our place in the body of Christ and accomplish the Great Commission, well, then others will perish. Right? So you need to see Christ. You need to see your place in Christ. You need to get in Christ and get saved. And once you get saved, it's important that you find your place in the body. Why? So that others can get saved. Else you're going to have a hard time accomplishing God's will. And so we want to start here because Jesus came to this earth on a rescue mission, and now we are actively here to engage in that same mission. He handed off the mission to disciples. That's why we have a vision conference. We remind ourselves of what God has given to the apostles, and then, of course, what was handed off to the apostle Paul, what was given to the churches, and what's been delivered to us. We've been given a perfect word, a perfect opportunity to accomplish God's mission, and so that's what we do. So this past week, we started a journey, if you remember, and we talked about being on this rescue mission, a mission really to sharpen our vision is what we wanted to do this week, and so that people don't perish. The time that we have is so precious, we don't want to let a word of God fall to the ground. I pray that's our heart, right? The word of God doesn't need to fall to the ground. We don't need to waste it. So I want to just review with you a little bit about what we've covered, just so that we can pick up and consider our vision. Because last Sunday morning when we met, we talked about three things. And that was the three things was in regard to investing. Right? In Luke chapter 19, we talked about wise investors, we talked about willing investors, and we talked about reluctant investors. And I pray that everyone this week is a wise investor. At the minimum, be a willing investor, because you don't want to be a reckless and reluctant investor with God's resources. So this past week, God filled our cup. If you were here Sunday night, man, what a great time it was. We heard a testimony from chaplain of the military of Sierra Leone and missionary Mike Pepper. What a great presentation. And then we began a journey from church plant to church plant. And as we went through that, we highlighted several key ministries that God has established along the way. We didn't have time to look at all of them, but we heard testimony and report from ministry participant to ministry participant. And it was just a great time to just really see all that God is and all that God is doing in and through this church, taking us from fruit to fruit, faith to faith. And so this last Monday morning when we got together, we continued in that discussion of investing in the field, and we heard practical teaching and testimony of ministry happening in our community, as well as strategic investment. Mike Blake preached on the call to go to the south side of Monmouth, and was very encouraging from the word. He reminded us of the bit and the whip, and really encouraged us in the Lord. Randy Foster concluded by giving us a roadmap to outreach, and Steve Fleshman gave us a great outline of building a team in ministry, and it was a great time. And so in between those sessions, we heard a testimony of several ministries that are looking for participants, people who are willing to invest. And the reality is around HBF, if you look at the ministry, a lot of you are investing in different areas of ministry. It's not like everyone at HBF sitting on their pockets and 20% of the people are doing 80% of the work. In reality, at HBF, it's probably the opposite. I really do believe that probably 80% of the people or even more are engaged in ministry, doing a lot around here. And sometimes when you're in ministry, you feel like, well, nobody's willing to help me. Well, oftentimes a lot of people are busy helping in other areas, so you got to be careful. I remember when we first started the church, we were all kind of feeling that way. And then Ralph Sikowski took and did a spreadsheet and put everybody in it and listed all the different ministries. And we looked at it and we're like, wow, everybody around here is about as busy as they can be. So what's that mean? Well, that means we got to win more people to Christ and make more disciples. That's what that means, because there's many more souls to reach. There's more mission to accomplish. And that's really why we're put here anyway, right? It's not to get caught up in us, but to get caught up in what God would have us to do. And so we talked about that on Monday morning. And then Monday night, David Shelby came in and gave a brief update of what God was planning in Budapest, Hungary, and then proceeded to challenge us to invest the word of God in the souls of men and to give up and go. And then, boy, Sam Strickland came with a message from Luke chapter 12. And that message was on the rich farmer from the Jordan Valley. If you miss that, you miss something. And Sam preached on the misplaced values and the need for us to purchase gold, of course, right out of the passage that is our vision conference and our vision for this year. I counsel thee to buy me gold tried in the fire. And he just, boy, he preached. And he really helped us remember that we don't want to misplace our priorities. In Luke chapter 12 and verse 20, the Bible says, "But God said unto him, Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. And he spoke about the foolish man that invested in things that meant nothing. And ultimately, his soul would be required." Then the text goes on to say, "Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God." And there's nothing wrong with God blessing financially. That's not the point. But the point is, if you're a foolish investor, if you gain this world and lose your own soul. And so, man, that was a challenge. So Tuesday morning we launched off and we heard from Mark Schaefer from Proverbs 16. And he just tilled the heart, asking us a big question. La gran pregunta. Lionel and Amenta aren't here to the next one. I have to remember that. And so the big question, why? Why? Why do we do what we do? Right? And he talked about the preparations of the heart and the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. Then he just went through the Proverbs 16 and challenged us to be prepared for battle, because Deuteronomy 21 doesn't say if battle comes, it says when the battle comes. How many were here to hear that? A couple of you, yeah, a few of you. Man, it was a good message. Not when the battle comes, or if the battle comes, when the battle comes. Are we ready? Is our heart prepared? Are we ready for what is to come? And of course, that's why we equip and challenge people in the Word of God. That's why discipleship is so important. So he challenged us to check our motives and remember that in the battle, who is with us? God is with us, right? The end of the Great Commission. Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. So God is with us. Beloved, those are some precious words that God brought to our church. And man, I'm hanging on to those things. Those are incredible truths from the Word of God. And then Dan Renault followed right up behind that and preached a practical message on the building the church planting team. And it was so practical. And he left us with some key points. The cultivation of the hearts and the minds must culminate with harvest. Those are some big words. But what's that mean? Man, there ought to be fruit from our lives, right? Our heart and our minds and the labor, the things that we're doing ought to produce some fruit. That's really why we just need to be busy about God's business. But at the end of the day, harvest is the goal. And so God assembles the team with people who are already willing to do their part. And he shared testimony of how they were just digging. Somebody shared with me how encouraged they were just to hear that analogy of just digging and digging and digging. and digging so much they didn't even realize that there were other people in the same field digging with them. I dig that message. Now, that was a good illustration as they were doing their work in the field. Are we doing our work in the field? Are we digging? Are we busy about God's business? Are we keeping our nose to the grindstone? Are we diligent? That was, in essence, what he was challenging us with. And then he concluded with another point. When you join a local New Testament church, you're already joining a mission unit that's already been sent, which kind of goes without saying, but sometimes we forget that. Oh, God, I want to go on a mission. Well, if you're a member of this local church, you're on one, because this is a unit that's been sent out to accomplish the mission, and that's what we do. So Dan answered this question, how can I be sent? He said, follow the leadership of the local church, invest in personal evangelism, go outside the influence of the local church, which is, what does that mean? Go beyond the sphere of the local church influence, and that's what he was doing as a church planner. That's what Brian Hedges did in the team that started this church. We went beyond the borders, so to speak, of where our church had influence, and God sent us right to the next town. That's what we do. That's why we went from church plant to church plant. And we talked about that on Sunday night. And we're trusting the Lord to plant churches in the county seats around HBF, because we want to go beyond that. And so those were some good times. And then Tuesday night, Sam Strickland came in, and he preached a powerful message on the four C's, right, of the Good Samaritan. The four C's: compassion for those who love him. No, compassion for those who hate him, right? The Good Samaritan gave compassion to people who hated him. He made that point that, right, the Jews had more grace, they had more compassion for a Gentile than a Samaritan, right? They would kick a Samaritan to the curb in a heartbeat and go to a Gentile. They weren't about to mess with Samaritans. They hated Samaritans, and yet the Samaritan ministered to that Jew. That Samaritan ministered to that Jew is a good message. And he also went on to teach us and tell us that he would contact those that were hurting, right? He went out of his way to touch the hurting. He cared for those who were hurting, and it cost him. He paid the bill, and it was a good message and practical in how we can invest in the field. And then Wednesday night was outstanding as we heard from Laura about her upcoming investment in the orphans of Orissa and prayed for Doug and Bethany as they would prepare to go to Cambodia. And then once again, Sam came with a strong message about the company of the curious, the company of the convinced, the company of the crucified, and the company of the committed. And boy, that was a powerful message out of John chapter 6. So we concluded with a commitment to continually invest willingly and wisely and not reluctantly. And we celebrated. Now since then, you've slept. And much of what I've said may have fallen to the ground. And it's my prayer, not that you memorize every sermon that's ever preached, but that God does a work in our hearts. And when God speaks, we listen. And when God speaks, we don't just kind of let it go to the wayside, but we say, Lord, do a work in my heart. Make this vision real, because I know you're trying to get me and us where we're trying to go. We're not just here to waste time in life. We can't do that. There's not enough time, number one. And number two, we're going to be accountable for the days spent on this earth. And this is the team that God's assembled. If you're a member of this church, this is your team. And so you're on it, right? So we got to know what the team is doing. We got to be tuned into the Word of God. Then we got to find our place so that we can accomplish God's mission and God's power for God's glory. And so that's why we have a vision conference. And it's important that we remember what God has said to us. It's not every day that we're able to gather as one man and hear the Word of God directed to us. Right? We're not taking care of the kids. Someone's doing that for us. And God gathers us, and it is this is what it is. It's a precious time. In our text in 1 Samuel, look at the first verse of chapter 3. And the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli. And look at this. And the word of the Lord was precious in those days. There was no open vision. No open vision. The word of the Lord was precious, like a precious metal, hard to find. Out of 52 weeks of the year, we only get 1 week of the year where we gather together. I guess we get 2 weeks because we do church in the park. 2 weeks of the year where we gather together as one man. And we get to hear the word of the Lord without the distractions of the other things that we have to do in ministry, to do ministry week to week. And that's an incredible opportunity that we have. And one of those times, of course, the focus is not inward, it's outward. As we go to the church at the park, it's always an evangelistic effort. And so this morning, I want to just be careful that as we move forward, because next week we're back to the same thing. We're back to the, well, actually next week's Easter, so I take that back. After Easter, right, we'll be back to Psalms, and we'll finish up Psalms. We're almost done with Psalms. Then we'll move on to the next series and so on and so forth. And I just don't want us to settle in, get complacent. I don't want that to happen, because that's what happened to Eli. You see, there was religious blindness that set in. If you look at verse 2, it says, "And it came to pass, at that time when Eli was laid down in his place, and his eyes began to wax dim, that he could not see." Right? And we read the rest of this, and we know that he couldn't hear very well either. Now, he could hear, he just couldn't perceive what was going on. And so the word of the Lord was precious, and there was no open vision. It's precious like precious metal. Kind of like this right here, this gold. We call that a precious metal. Now when you get to heaven, it's no big deal. It's all over the streets. It's paved. Pavement. That's what they call it in heaven. It's pavement. But here, man, it's precious. It's precious. And of course, it is a precious metal. It's the standard established really by God, because it represents so much. But it was precious because, well, there was no open vision. The Lord was not speaking to Israel because, well, they were faithless and not believing. They didn't do anything with what he already said. See, God had already spoken. He gave them the law of Moses. He gave them the promised land. Their job was to actually just do what it was that they were told to do. They were to set up the priesthood. They were to execute on the priesthood's office, and they were to do the sacrifices. They were to keep the fasts. Oh, yeah, and when there are enemies that come with chariots of iron and all that, you know what you do? You go out and you fight them, and you win because you're full of faith. But what happened? It didn't go that way, did it? Before it's over, the Philistines creep in. Faithlessness sets in. The next thing you know, they're bondage. They're in bondage, and they're slaves. And there's no open vision. Seems like God hadn't spoken to us in a long time. It's like the 400 silent years between in the Old Testament before God brought forth the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord was not speaking to Israel because they were faithless and not believing. He didn't place them in the promised land to bow and cower to the gods of their enemies, but to be a nation, right, a peculiar people, zealous of good works, that could actually show the world that there was a God in heaven. Not multiple gods with a small g, not a bunch of pagan deities, but there was a God, Jehovah God, and he was the God, the one true God that created everything. It was their job to steward this information and be a light to the nations. God had always intended that. And they find themselves in fear. They had the law, and they knew what to do. They simply didn't obey the vision that God had given them. And notice Eli. He was laid down in his place, and his eyes began to wax dim. He couldn't see. He couldn't see a thing. You know, Eli was resting when he should have been working, when he should have been praying, when he should have been serving, and his vision was growing dim. I don't have time to, I wish I had time. I could just preach this one story. It'd be awesome. You know his two sons. Go back and read the story if you've never read it. Hophni and Phinehas. They're horrible. They're horrible. These two men are wicked. They're abusing the office, right? They're abusing the privilege of the priesthood. It's a terrible thing that's going on. And Eli's impotent to do anything about it. Just like Israel's impotent to do anything about the enemies that oppress him. And Eli serves as a metaphor. This serves as a metaphor for Eli and the nation of Israel, because God forbid that it serves as a metaphor for us, right? We don't want to be blind. But what does Jesus say to the church of Laodicea? Thou sayest you're rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. But you really don't know that you're bankrupt. And we can identify with that in a practical sense. Why? Because we live on credit. I've got a credit card too. And so I could be really hurting right now, but you wouldn't know it. Why? Because I can keep extending credit. But that's only good until the bills come due. And then when you don't have any assets to cover that debt, guess what? It isn't going to matter anymore, is it? Because they'll think you're rich, increase with goods, but you really can't afford that lifestyle. And really, oftentimes, that's what's going on in the church. We're living on credit, thinking, oh, well, I'll just keep faking it till I make it. But God is crying out to us and saying, no, don't do that. Let's get authentic, man. Let's get with Jesus. Let's pray. Let's actually read our Bibles. Let's not go to church and pretend we're Christians. Let's actually be the church and go out and accomplish God's mission. Let's actually be engaged in a relationship with God. I mean, really, there are Christians, probably even in our church, that don't even crack their Bible in the course of a week to see what God is saying to them. And I tell you guys, I get that if you just got saved, maybe, but really when you get saved, you're usually hungry. And even though you can't understand it and you're scratching your head, you're still kind of searching. But I mean, as Christians, man, we've got to be about investing in the things that keep our eyes open, right? They keep us going toward the prize, right? To set our, not just have our knowledge, like knowledge puffeth up, charity, our heart has to be set on things above. We have to have a heart for God. See, that was what made the difference. That's what pulled Israel out of this doldrum, was finally a man, a boy, just like Samuel. God got a hold of some kids. You know, the best thing that might be happening at our church could be happening in the E-Wing, right? God got a hold of some kids that said, whoa, we believe the Bible. We'll hear the word. We'll pick up the word. Samuel didn't let a word fall to the ground. The word was precious. This is more valuable than gold, the word of God. Now, I know I'm preaching in the choir, but when we lose vision, we lose passion to serve the Lord. In 1 Samuel 3 and verse 3, it says, And ere the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was, and Samuel was laid down to sleep. I could talk about Samuel's call, and that'd be a nice message, but I want to focus on this lamp that went out. The light went out in the temple of the Lord. Some of us have received Christ as Savior, and you're like a child. Maybe you just got saved recently. We're going to have 3 baptisms here in the next service. Praise the Lord for that. And you know, when a baby is born, they don't see everything. They're still trying to figure out mama, dada. You know, they're just looking, what is all this world of wonder? Their vision's kind of coming into, you know, focus. That's fine. You don't expect a baby to have clarity or to understand everything around them, right? It takes time for all that to develop. When we get saved, right, that's what happens. It takes time in the Word. It takes time as a disciple. It takes time to really learn and grow and understand fully everything that's happened. As a matter of fact, it takes you the rest of your life to figure out what's happened the moment you got saved. I still don't quite fully grasp the gravity of all of it. And as I preach, it sets in even more upon me. It makes me even more fired up about it. I mean, that's why we keep going back to that good old story, because it is so impactful. It's incredible what God does to us. When we get saved, the gift of God is eternal life, and that is huge in meaning and depth. But a child, they don't know all that. Their vision is, well, it's just weak, and it's growing, and they're learning. But some of us have been around a while, and we've allowed the passion to wane. We've taken for granted how we've gotten here and how fortunate we are to be in the service of the Lord and to have the opportunities that we really do have. You know, Eli was like what I would consider a second or third, maybe a fourth, maybe even longer generation Christian who forgot what God did or did not do and correlate all of that victory from the past to today's service. You see, Eli wasn't really jiving, right? He wasn't really grooving with why God put him in the position that he was in. He didn't really believe he could make a difference. You know why? He wasn't making one. If he believed that God was going to use him, you know what? He'd have acted differently. He'd have taken it more seriously. He would have engaged full-heartedly. Not fool-heartedly, but full-heartedly. Instead, he was a fool. Just like Sam preached on. And the reality is this. There's times as Christians, we get into this. Man, when I went to Atlanta, I learned a little bit about Baptist culture. I thought we had it in the Midwest up here, but boy, they got it down there in the Southeast, I'm telling you. I mean, I was like, whoa, crazy. I mean, you could go to church your whole life and never get, I mean, it's just like, wow. Lots of church going on down there. But why are we doing all this? right? We're doing all this because people are dying and going to hell. Some of them might be sitting in the church, especially down in the South. That's unbelievable. Sometimes we can get complacent. Eli's been now several generations removed from Joshua and Caleb, several generations away from that movement of God that brought in the promised land and started all this. And now he's just kind of complacent. Always been here. It's always been like this. It's all good. It's always going to be here. That candle is supposed to stay lit, by the way. He wasn't diligent about his service, was he? If we could continue to read the chapter, you know what? That ark wasn't ever supposed to go anywhere. It's supposed to stay in the Holy of Holies. But it ends up getting taken. Well, they did take it out the battle, which is always, it was foolish. But anyway, man, I tell you what. Eli wasn't on his A game. He got complacent. Maybe you've been raised in a godly home. And it's not that you backslid, but that you just can't advance the kingdom. But you don't understand. That's why God put you here, to advance it beyond your parents. You say, well, yeah, you know, those stories, I don't have the same situation, right? Your parents were busy killing all the giants of this and that and the other thing just to get you in the promised land. But listen to me. Second, third, fourth, fifth generation, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth generation, Christians that have a tendency to get complacent and say, well, my testimony really isn't that big of a deal. No, your testimony is everything. Because it's your job to go forward with the vision. It's your job to take it to the next level. Do you know what David did? He took it to the next level. You think he didn't fight giants? Yeah, he fought giants. There's going to be giants for you to fight too. There's going to be battles for you to fight. There's going to be work for you to do just as much as the generations before. You're not exempt. If you're in the battle, man, if you're in Christ, God's going to bring the battle. We cannot fall asleep. We cannot let the generations behind us fall asleep because the battle is on. And men have to believe that they're in the battle and that they're going somewhere and they got to be on the course. And it starts in every household in our church. Every man in our church and every single mother in our church has to say, wait, I'm on a team and we're going to war. We cannot fall asleep like Eli. We can't let the candle go out in the temple. We got to be diligent about the word of God. And the business that God's called us to. The sad consequences of religious blindness. They set in. Look at chapter 4. Just flip over to verse 11. And the ark of God was taken, and the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were slain. No love lost there for Hophni and Phinehas. They were rascals. They had it coming. But you know what? Eli lost his kids. Oh, yeah, and by the way, so he lost the ark. Verse 12, and there ran a man and Benjamin out of the army and came to Shiloh the same day with his clothes rent and with earth upon his head. And when he came, verse 13, lo, Eli sat upon a seat by the wayside watching for his heart trembled for the ark of God. And when the man came into the city and told it, all the city cried out, and Eli heard the noise of the crying, and he said, what meaneth the noise of this tumult? And the man came in hastily and told Eli. Now Eli was 98 years old, and his eyes were dim, and he could not see. Now he's completely blind. And the man said unto Eli, I am he that came out of the army, and I fled today, cut off of the army. And he said, what is there done, my son? And the messenger answered and said, Israel has fled before the Philistines, and there hath not been also a great slaughter among the people, and thy two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are dead, and the ark of God is taken. And it came to pass, when he made mention of the ark of God, that he fell from off the seat backward by the side of the gate, and his neck brake, and he died. For he was an old man and heavy, and he had judged Israel 40 years. That's the end of Eli. Man, the sad consequence of religious blindness is that people perish. Hophni and Phinehas died. Now, yeah, they had it coming to them, but you know what? That was Eli's sons, even though they were in apostasy. The ark of God was taken. The most precious things were hijacked by the world for a season by those Philistines. The law and the priesthood were ripped from Israel because of the lack of vision. Eli was crushed under the pressure of his own weight. Verse 18. What a picture of the lazy minister. Sam Strickland said, a man who will not work will find no comfort in the promises of Scripture. Because why? We get saved under good works, Ephesians 2:10. What a picture of the culmination of a life well wasted is the flesh of Eli grew fat and crushed him under his own weight, broke his neck. Our flesh is like spiritual cancer. We can ill afford to feed it, and I like to feed mine, by the way, lest we get consumed by it. It breaks our neck, our will to serve God. There are some who will not go out by faith today. And there's legitimate reasons why people won't go out today for this and that and the other reason. But it isn't because of this or that and the other reason. It's because simply their flesh is too much for them to compensate. They can't face their flesh and say, no, I'm going to go in faith instead of fear. They can't tell their flesh no. And it not just affects opportunities to go out and do, that's a great analogy, but it affects everything. I'll talk about that more in just a minute. The Spirit of the Lord departed, it says in verses 19 through 22, and it says his daughter-in-law, Phinehas' wife, was with child, near to be delivered. And when she heard the tidings that the ark of God was taken and her father-in-law and her husband were dead, she bowed herself and travailed, and her pains came upon her. And about the time of her death, the woman stood by her and said unto her, fear not, for thou hast borne a son. But she answered not, neither did she regard it. And the name of the child was Ichabod, saying, the glory is departed from Israel, because the ark of God was taken, and because her father-in-law and her husband. You see, that's what Jesus is pleading with the church of Laodicea. He's saying, hey, I don't want to mess with your candlestick. Right? Those churches are candlesticks, and in the midst of them is the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't let your candlestick go out. Don't let the Spirit of the Lord depart. Now, you guys know, as a Christian, the Spirit of the Lord can't depart from us. Our souls are sealed to the day of redemption. We can't lose our salvation. But, you know, I bet there are times when the Spirit of God is so grieved and quenched, you wish he could. In fact, there are some times, the Bible teaches in 1 Corinthians 11, that God gets so grieved and quenched with the disobedience of his children that he finally does just take them home because he's tired of living in their carcass and willing disobedience. He doesn't break their neck. He just takes them out. And he returns from to where he came. That is one way for the Spirit to be loosed from the grief of the suffering of a carnal Christian. And that's not the way we want to go. That's the religious Christian. Are you encouraged today? All right. I hope so. We will be. Hang on. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 39. Jeremiah 39. You don't want to be the religious Christian that's blind, right? You don't want to be that person. So that's not who we want to be. We want to be the person who, man, we're fellowshipping with Jesus. Now go to Jeremiah chapter 39. This won't take long. Jeremiah 39. I want you just to see another guy. Man, this is a king. King Zedekiah. King Zedekiah. Quite a man in quite a difficult situation. Babylon is coming upon the nation of Israel. God's fulfillment of prophecy for their disobedience is coming to pass. And Zedekiah now is the king. Now, in verses 5 and 6 of chapter 39, the Bible says, but the Chaldean army pursued after them and overtook Zedekiah in the plains of Jericho. And when they had taken him, they brought him up to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, to Riblah in the land of Hamath, where he gave judgment upon him. And then the king of Babylon slew the sons of Zedekiah in Riblah before his eyes. Also, the king of Babylon slew all the nobles of Judah. Moreover, he put out Zedekiah's eyes and bound him with chains to carry him to Babylon. Now, this is a sad situation because this is not necessarily how the story had to end. You see, Zedekiah had every opportunity to hear the word of God. He simply did not heed it. Look in chapter 28 or 38, just the previous chapter. Just look down in verse 15. It says, "Then Jeremiah said unto Zedekiah, If I declare unto you, unto thee, wilt thou not surely put me to death? And I have thee counsel, and if I give thee counsel, wilt thou not hearken unto me?" So Zedekiah the king swore secretly unto Jeremiah, saying, "As the Lord liveth, that made us this soul, I will not put thee to death, neither will I give thee into the hand of the men that seek thy life." Then said Jeremiah unto Zedekiah, "Thus saith the Lord, the God of hosts, the God of Israel, if thou wilt assuredly go forth unto the king of Babylon's princes, then thy soul shall live, and this city shall not be burned with fire. And thou shalt live," look at this, "and thine house. But," verse 18, "if thou wilt not go forth to the king of Babylon's princes, then shall this city be given into the hand of the Chaldeans, and they shall burn it with fire, and thou shalt not escape out of their hand." And Zedekiah the king said unto Jeremiah, "I am afraid of the Jews that are fallen to the Chaldeans, lest they deliver me into their hand, and they mock me." But Jeremiah said, "They shall not deliver thee. Obey, I beseech thee, the voice of the Lord, which I speak unto thee. So it shall be well with thee, and thy soul shall live." You know what God told Zedekiah? Sam, can you hand me that water? He told him, if you just obey this prophecy, what a great, gracious word from God. If you really look at the whole story of Israel, I mean, did Zedekiah deserve that kind of grace? No. I mean, what an opportunity. What a great privilege to keep Israel, Jerusalem in place, the kingly line in place, his heritage in place. I mean, whew, what a deal. But what stopped him? What stopped him? Well, it's in the text. Ultimately, what stopped him was he was afraid. He's afraid of what everybody else, his brothers, were going to think when he obeyed the Lord. Can you imagine that? A time where doing what's right, doing what the God tells you to do, becomes something that is counted as wrong or foolish? Beloved, that day is upon you. That day's upon you. We got to be committed to the Word of God and the promises of God's Word. You can't worry about what everybody thinks. You can't get caught up in political correctness. You know, we don't have to be stupid. We don't have to be jerk faces. We don't have to be dumb. But at the end of the day, there's only one word, and it's God's word. Jeremiah says, would you just obey the word? It's going to be good for you. It's going to be good for everybody else. He's the man who lives in fear. It's rebellious blindness. He lives in fear of what everyone else thinks. And while it may have been wise to keep his cards close to the vest, he didn't obey the voice of the Lord at length. And the consequence of rebellious blindness, oh, it's great. If he would have obeyed, it wouldn't have turned out that way. But because he didn't obey, because he didn't submit to God's plan for Nebuchadnezzar's authority, if he would have just submitted to that, his sons would have lived. Jerusalem would have been preserved, and captivity would have looked a lot different than it ended up looking. But rebellion is not always open. It can be manifest in submission to the wrong counsel instead of the fear of the Lord. And so we don't want to be religiously blind. We don't want to be rebelliously blind like Zedekiah. What we want to be is we want to have a vision that's restored. Turn to Mark chapter 8 and we'll be done. Mark chapter 8. This won't take long. Mark chapter 8. And there's a lot of blind folks getting healed in the Bible, in the Gospels. Jesus Christ made a habit of restoring vision. Right? He wants us to see. May God give us the grace to see this morning. Mark chapter 8, verse 24, the Bible says, "And he looked up and said, verse 22, and he cometh to Bethsaida, and they bring a blind man unto him, and besought him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes and put his hands upon him, he asked him if he saw aught. And he looked and said, I see men as trees walking. And after that, he put his hands again upon his eyes and made him look up, and he was restored and saw every man clearly. And he sent him away to his house, saying, neither go into the town nor tell it to any in the town." What a great picture this is. The blind man can be healed even from Bethsaida. Now, Bethsaida in Scripture, there's a lot that's said there about once they reject Jesus, about the judgment that's upon them. This is also the same region that Andrew and Simon, Simon hailed from. But at length, they reject Jesus along with all Israel. And so you may come from a place where Jesus isn't admired or respected or even recognized, other than curse words. But you know what's awesome about that today? It doesn't mean he won't heal you. It doesn't matter where you come from. God's going to, if you're willing to allow him to touch you, he'll heal you. And I love this picture here because Jesus applies the eye salve, right? That we talk about in Revelation 3. Anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. And oftentimes it's curious. Why does he only see like 50%? Is something wrong with Jesus? Well, no, of course not. Jesus is remarking in a picture of this man on everything I just said. Because we know from Romans chapter 11 that blindness in part has happened to Israel. Why? Because Jesus came to his own, and his own received him not. But this man waited, and he said, touch me again. And Jesus touched him, and you know what? He saw all men clearly. It's a picture for us of what Jesus Christ really is. He's the fulfillment of the law. In him, it's yea, yea, right? It's green light, go. As Christians, we have no excuse for not knowing what to do, because we have the whole counsel of God's word. We don't see men as trees to be gathered up and cast into the fire. We see men as they ought to be, in the image and the likeness of God who created them. And we have a message, we have a gospel that can get them there. Amen? Amen. That's why God has given us vision. And that's why Jesus Christ gathers us together, a candlestick, and Jesus is in our midst. And he says, guys, the lights are on in the house of God. Steward that vision. Take it where it needs to go. Why? Because there's men. There are souls at stake. And we've got to take the vision where it needs to go. And so today, if we're not doing what we need to do, just remember Revelation chapter 3 and verse 19. Be zealous, right? And repent. That's what it says in Revelation 3:19. Get some passion back. Don't be like Eli. Get a little pep in your step and get busy about the business that God has for you. Revelation 3 and verse 19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Right? Go back and do what it is you know you're supposed to be doing. Stop doing what it is you know you're not supposed to be doing, and get in gear so that God can take you, and you can be that man like Samuel who doesn't let a word fall to the ground. That man like David who says, hey, man, it may have been 10 generations ago when Grandpa Judah came into the promised land, but you know what? I'm going to fight a real battle. And we're going to see some giants go down. Amen? Hey, today we're going to go take you to the streets. You're all welcome to come. And I guarantee you, we're going to see some giants go down. That's what we do. We go fight Philistines. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for the Lord Jesus Christ. My time is up.